through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And the collect for today. Gracious God, you cause the fullness of life. Deliver us from unbelief and banish our anxieties with the liberating love of Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And we sit for our first reading.
Thank you. Something is good, but if something has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourself and be at peace with one another. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Oh, there's a passage for Sunday morning. Please do take a seat. I did actually print my sermon, but I left it in the car, so that's where I've got my laptop. My name's David. I am an ordinand in the Church of England as of this month, so I'm a very new ordinand. And Lucy has asked me to speak today while she's on sabbatical, and it's a real privilege to be here. I was working with Lucy on the deanery plan, and she always spoke with such great affection about you guys. And it was a lovely service last week, and it's just a real joy to be here. Carol was talking about welcoming people into church and welcoming children, and I'm only really a baby Christian on my best days, so I'm going to take you up on that invitation today. So I'm going to be looking at Mark 9. It's a difficult passage. It's a difficult passage to read. It's even harder to preach on. I have a friend in my Bible group who has been a preacher for about 30 years, and he said, "Oh, I wouldn't want to preach on that passage." So I'm hoping that you can, receive what I'm about to say with some gentleness. And will you help me by praying before I speak? So, Father, thank you that you allow even your little ones to speak. I pray that you cover my words, Lord, with your grace. I pray that you just draw near to us as we explore your words together. Amen. I'd like to start with a little story. So when I was younger, when I was very little, I used to get a lot of ear infections. And when this happened, sometimes they were bad enough that my mum or dad would take me out of school and I'd have to go to work with them. But the strange thing was that they were teachers, and so instead of being in my school, my junior school, I would be in their secondary school with the older children. And I think that, I don't know if any of you have teachers as parents, but it can be quite an odd thing to see your mum or your dad teaching. Because you know, they have this relationship of authority with the children that they're teaching, but because you see them at home, you sort of feel like you're in on the act, or you feel like in some way that you're on their side. And I'd see my dad disciplining children, and you know, I'd feel like, well, my dad is your boss, so I'm kind of like on his level. And I think it gave me funny ideas about who I was in relation to the older children. I tell you this story because I think it's exactly what the disciples are doing in Mark chapter 9. All throughout this chapter, we've seen the disciples, the close followers of Jesus, trying to get in on the act of being the Messiah. They've been watching Jesus' ministry and trying to figure out what are the principles by which Jesus is making his decisions. How does he do it? Well, you know, what's Jesus' way of doing things? And so earlier in Mark chapter 9, they try and cast out a demon, not very successfully. They try to turn away some children, presumably because they think that that's what a rabbi and a teacher would expect. And here in today's reading, they come to Jesus and say, "We saw someone driving out demons in your name, and we told him to stop." And when they say this to Jesus, they expect him to be pleased. You know, in our reading last week, they were too ashamed to tell Jesus what they were talking about on the road. Whereas this week, they're coming to him and telling him, "Oh, we, you know, this other guy, and he's casting out demons in your name, but he's not one of us, so we told him to stop." They're expecting Jesus' approval, and they're trying to demonstrate to Jesus that they're such good pupils of his teaching that they even know who's in and who's out of his ministry. They're trying to do that thing that I did as a small child when I'm there with my dad teaching and feeling like, well, I'm on your side, I'm a bit like you. And who is this person that they're trying to turn away? For someone to be casting out demons in Jesus' name, well, they must have heard of Jesus' name. They probably would have listened to some of his teaching. And I would wager a guess that they probably had enough faith in Jesus' name to think that it would be an effective name for casting out demons. And so this is someone who you could describe as a follower of Jesus, but the disciples tell him to stop. Why is that? Well, he's not part of our group. That's a big part of it.
He's not doing it the way that we would do it. We think that you would do it, Jesus. He's not one of us. He's perhaps sort of, you know, not really part of the group that's following Jesus around from town to town. And I see this behaviour all too often amongst Christians today. You know, you might think, oh, that church over there, they're doing it wrong. Or you might think, when someone joins you in church, that's not how you behave in church. We've got lots of rules, haven't we, about how we expect to behave in church, how we expect to do things. Or we might see someone else's lifestyle and say, oh no, that's not how Jesus wants us to live. I don't know if you recognise this attitude at all in yourself. I remember one time being sat in a church, I won't say which one, very much like this, it wasn't this one. And there was a lady, there was a teenager in front of me. So about a pew in front of me, there was a teenager, she was on her phone, she had her knees up on the pew in front of her, she wasn't paying any attention to the service at all. And she reminded me of myself. That's exactly how I used to go to church. And I made sure that everyone knew I didn't want to be there. And I saw what was going to happen next in slow motion. There was a lady behind me, and she got up and went over to the teenager, tapped her on the shoulder, and hissed in her ear, "Show some respect." And maybe that's something that you would never do yourselves, but I think that all of us have at times seen this behaviour creep into our own hearts. Sometimes it's our theology. So I became a Christian not long after getting married, and I remember saying to my very good friend, the best man at my wedding at some point afterwards, I was like, oh, you know, I don't really believe in sex before marriage now. And he said, oh, well, it's very easy to believe that now, isn't it? And I often wonder why on earth I felt the need to tell him that. You know, presumably because I thought Jesus was, you know, approving of what I was saying. You know, but as a single person, as someone, you know, talking to me, I never followed that rule until I became a Christian, and then it was too late to put that rule into place. I don't know how that would have been received. I think sometimes it's the way in which we do church. You know, we can have a comfortable routine and think, well, this is how we do church, and someone comes in who doesn't know how to do it our way, and we think, well, this is how you do it. And I think we can be very confident that we have the right way. I think sometimes the worst things that we do as Christians come not when we're ignoring the teachings of Jesus, but when we're so confident that we're following his instructions and his way of life, that we feel like we're acting on his authority. It comes when we think we have such a good grasp of who Jesus is and what Jesus was teaching and how church should be done and our theology and how people get saved, that we start playing the role of Messiah in other people's lives. And I would say, you know, no sooner have we accepted the saving grace of Jesus in our own lives that we feel able to start dishing it out for other people. These are difficult teachings, I think. When we do this, I believe that we become the stumbling blocks that Jesus is warning us about, putting obstacles in the way of others from seeking faith. And Jesus warns us against this behaviour in the strongest possible terms. He says, if any of you do this, if any of you put a stumbling block for one of these little ones, you know, those with a little faith, those with a little understanding of Jesus, who Jesus is, the little ones in stature, the little ones who are, you know, on the outside of church, it would be better if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea. And it's this behaviour that causes Jesus to issue such a stark warning about the risk of damnation and the fire of hell. And do you know what's really sad? I think often we've taken the exact opposite meaning from this passage. You know, it's better to cut off your hand than to enter into hell, and it's better to take out your eye than enter into hell. And we use that as a clobber verse, a verse to clobber people with and say how awful sin is and how serious sin is, and in a way that people receive as a stumbling block. So where does that behaviour come from? So the lady I told you about who was rude to the teenager, I went and spoke to her after the service, and she was so apologetic. She was honestly genuinely repentant, and she knew that she shouldn't have done it. And she said to me, oh, I just don't know why I did it. And then she said to me, I just get so frustrated when I see young people missing out on church, missing out on the truth about Jesus. She's a very committed Christian, and that's where it came from. It came from a sense of frustration. And I don't think it's wrong to feel that. Jesus himself is making it really clear in this passage. There's nothing in this life that could be worse than missing out on the kingdom of God? It would be better to lose even precious parts of our body than to miss out on the joy and the grace of salvation in the kingdom of God by giving our lives to Jesus. And maybe there are people in your life that you know are missing out on this reality. It may even be you. Maybe you haven't given your life to Jesus yet. Maybe, you know, this is something that is still a decision that you haven't yet made in your own life. For those people, and if it's for you, I would say there's nothing at all I could want more for you than to know the love and the grace of Jesus. It's the best thing that's ever happened to my life. But I think in our hurry to share the joy of salvation, let's not take it upon ourselves to start, you know, labouring people with, burdening people with theology and ways of doing church and rules about lifestyles and stuff that actually isn't essential to understanding who Jesus is and the amazing invitation that Jesus gives us. Because when we go throughout the Bible, there's one of these sentences in the passage that we just had, you get these whoever statements, and they're statements that start with the word whoever. And they're really encouraging. I would encourage you to go and look up the whoever statements in the Bible, because the vast majority of them are incredibly encouraging. And when you read these statements, you realise just how broad and how wide the invitation is to know Jesus. Let me read a few of these out. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Whoever gives so much as a cup of water will not lose their reward. We mustn't make this invitation any less open than it has already been made to us. Let me close with an illustration of how that works. Because my preacher friend from my Bible group was trying to impress upon me, well, the other thing, he's a very strong and ardent evangelical, and I love him to bits. He's really trying to insist upon me, well, you know, don't lose the fact that, you know, salvation is so important, you know, that sin is so deadly. Don't lose that fact. And I said, no, I'm not losing that fact. So here's an illustration of how that works. So imagine that you're in a burning building. Maybe this one. There isn't a fire. I shouldn't cry fire in a building, but imagine this one. The flames are going up, the columns, the walls are on fire. And then you hear a fire engine outside, and someone calls out over the tannoy. Whoever leaves through the fire exit is going to get out safely. What do you do? You start running towards the fire exit, don't you? What you don't do is appoint yourself the fire marshal. What you don't do is start throwing stones at people who are heading towards the fire exit. What you don't do is start dragging them along with you if they're not heading towards the fire exit. Because what that's going to do is spook people and think, well, the fire exit probably isn't a good thing if this person is treating me so badly and making it seem, you know, so awful. So let's not stand around throwing stones at people who are not moving towards the fire exit. Let's head towards the fire exit and, of course, encourage other people and say, there's a fire exit, let's get towards the fire exit. But clearing obstacles out of the way as we go. So that's, I think, the encouraging part of this passage, which has so much really stark warnings in it. So I'm just going to close and invite you to sort of pray with me and reflect on this. Let's close our eyes. And let's just take a moment to ask God, in what ways have I been putting stumbling blocks in the way of others that are seeking faith, that are seeking the fire exit? Maybe you yourself are someone who has encountered these stumbling blocks to faith in your own life. What did that feel like? And I'd like us to imagine these times that we've experienced, you know, perhaps powerful words that people have said to us, or, you know, burdensome ideas and rules and expectations that have got in the way of us finding Jesus and heading towards the fire exit in our own lives. I'd like you to imagine those times as big, heavy blocks of concrete. And God, with just a simple word or with his breath, just blows them out of the way so that we just have a clear path to Jesus. Let us pray. Father of mercies, we turn to you and we place our trust in you. Help us to take up your invitation to
to be saved. Help us, Jesus, not to place stumbling blocks in the way of other people who are seeking faith. Guide us towards the fire exit and help us to encourage others to come along with us. Let us know your peace again today.
Teach us to be open and generous in our dealings, to dedicate ourselves to the service of others and you, to friends, relatives, family, strangers, and people we do not like. Bless the families and communities in which we live, and the places where we work and play. As we grow together in an intimate and mutually dependent relationship, help us to flourish in the warmth of your regard. We remember also all who have suffered from malnutrition, hunger,
share the peace in the way we used to, but we can still stand up and smile or raise a hand in welcome and friendship, can't we? So let's stand as we come to share the peace together. The risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Thank you.
his risen life. As you feed us with these gifts, send your Holy Spirit and change us more and more to be like Jesus, our Saviour. Help us, Father, to love one another as we look forward to that day when suffering is ended and all creation is gathered in your loving arms. And now, with all your saints, we give you glory through Jesus Christ in the strength of the Spirit, today and Lord, we pray that your grace may always precede and follow us, and make us continually to be given to all good works, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty.